Takedown, breakdown. Since the decision by the White House earlier this month to rescind DACA, the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals program, a student-led activism group here in North Carolina at UNC has been posting every couple of days the life story of a DACA recipient in our community on the organization's website. Here is one of those stories posted. When someone asks me where I was born, I am never hesitant to say Ciudad de Mexico. Then they ask what I miss from Mexico and what it was like to live there. I can't never give them an answer because I have no recollection of living in that beautiful country. I arrived in the United States when I was 2.5 years old with my parents. They settled in North Carolina and it has been my home since. Today I am 19 years old and am a few months away from a bachelor's degree. All my life, my parents have instilled in me the value of education. They always told me they wanted my siblings and I to have a better life than they did. I have made it my mission for not only myself, but for them to do just that. I graduated in 2015 with my high school diploma, a Spanish interpreting certificate from Johnston Community College, and various college credit hours. In 2016, I received my first degree, which was an associate in science. In May of 2018, I will have a bachelor's degree in business administration with an emphasis in healthcare management. I've always had a passion for healthcare field, but I want to be on the administrative side of it. I can't do bodily fluids. I learned that from a certified nursing assistant class I took in the summer of 2016. I plan to pursue a master in public health degree after undergraduate studies. I want to dedicate my career to the vulnerable and the underserved on the healthcare spectrum. On top of school, I have had a job since I received deferred action for childhood arrivals at age 15. I'm also an older sister to 2 US citizens. They look up to me and rely on me for certain things, such as transportation to and from school, being their shoulder to cry on, and their listening ear. I do not think that they would be able to imagine a life without me, and I definitely cannot imagine a life without them. I know that I am valuable and an asset for this country. This is where I want to continue to build my life. I want to buy a home, buy a car, raise a family, and more. This is as much my country as it is anyone else's. My name is Miriam Amado Lopez, and I am resilient. Among the other testimonies you can read on that site, I'm Alejandro Escobar Lopez, and I am determined. My name is Ruby Franco Quiroz, and I am undocumented and unapologetic. My name is Johanna Isabel, and I am unstoppable. I wanted to preach this morning on immigration, but I wanted to do it in a specific way. I wanted to approach immigration in a way that wasn't about numbers and statistics, and I wanted to talk about immigration in a way that's not about uttering platitudes and soundbites that turn out to be banal and insipid and destructive because they're so often based on lies and propaganda. So I want to tell you a little bit about the source material for this sermon. For a lot of sermons that I give, my source material is the articles and the books that I've read in my theological training. But the source material for this sermon is a little bit different. Last Saturday, I attended, along with a group from this church, a conference at the United Church here in Chapel Hill, hosted by the North Carolina Council of Churches on Sanctuary. It was a diverse interfaith gathering. There were Unitarians in abundance and UCC, and Episcopalians and Presbyterians and Methodists and Baptists and Quakers and Mennonites and Jews and more. And there were stories told, powerful stories. And this morning I'm going to reference some of those stories. And then on Monday night I attended at UNC a forum about the consequences of rescinding DACA and what impact it will have on students and the community. There were undocumented students who spoke, both undocumented students who are part of the DACA program and those who are not. There were immigration lawyers, there were administrators. It was a full house. Every seat in the 300-person auditorium was filled. And I took notes, and I want to tell a few of those stories as well. And as I tell the stories, I have to tell you that I do so with some trepidation, not only because I want to make sure that I get it all right, but also because they are not my stories. I tell them to be helpful. And if it turns out that telling these stories turns out to be somehow exploitative or tokenizing, then I apologize for that. I tell these stories with good intentions. I'm not interested in statistics. I'm sick of hearing about 11 million undocumented persons living in the United States, about one person in every 30 in our country. How there are 800,000 DACA recipients in the United States, more than 27,000 DACA recipients in North Carolina, and dozens of DACA recipients currently enrolled in undergraduate or graduate school programs at UNC. But I don't want to talk about numbers, I want to talk about real people. Johanna Isbell writes, "I have been in the U.S. for the past 19 years. I was brought here at age 2 from Mexico. I remember nothing. My parents brought me here to obtain a better education and have better opportunities since they were not able to obtain that in Mexico. Through DACA, I was given the opportunity to work legally and to go to school. A year ago, I went through the toughest time in my life. My father was deported. So now I am providing for my family financially by working 50-hour weeks as a property manager, part-time as a waitress, and still putting myself through school. I'm in my first year of a nursing program to become a pediatric oncology nurse. I'm a first-generation student in my family, one of the first to have graduated from high school and pursue higher education. With my father's deportation, I now provide for my mother, my 9-year-old sister, my 11-year-old brother, provide for them and maintain a roof over their head." I want to talk about real people. I don't want to talk about platitudes and sound bites. And I'll tell you that the first sound bite that needs to go away is the term illegal or illegal alien. To use the phrase illegal or illegal alien is to perpetuate white supremacy. To use the phrase illegal or illegal alien is to perpetuate white supremacy, because here is the thing. It's not just that no person is illegal, which as a universalist I believe to be true. It's not just that immigration law is exceedingly complex, and you're probably not a lawyer. It is not just that as an American I believe in due process under the law and that all are innocent until they are proven guilty. It's all of those things, but it's also that we as a nation have a long, sick history of labeling brown people and black people and poor people as dangerous and criminal and outside the law. Let me break this down. There's a law that says it's illegal to employ someone who doesn't have the correct papers. You know that law. You've heard of that law. But we don't walk around talking about buying groceries from the illegal produce department or the illegal farmers market. You don't say that you're eating in an illegal restaurant. You don't say that you're sleeping in an illegal hotel or sleeping under the illegal roof of your house. For that matter, let's talk about white-collar crime. Some of us here probably have our money in illegal banks, own stock in illegal companies. Last year, Volkswagen got hit with a $2.8 billion fine for conspiracy to pollute. I bet if we went out into the parking lot, that we would find that some people here are driving a criminal brand of car. But we don't talk that way, right? If you talk like that way, people would look at me funny. We don't talk that way. And that's white supremacy. When you name brown people and black people and poor people criminal, illegal, gangster, thug, but you walk around like you're clean, that's white supremacism. I wish we could get away from the platitude says that we're a nation of laws. We are not a nation of laws. We are a nation of privilege. Don't hire 15,000 new border guards and immigration agents. Hire 15,000 auditors, tax accountants, and Wall Street investigators. Yeah. Hire 15,000 people to monitor civil rights violations and investigate hate crimes. Hire 15,000 people to look at lead in the drinking water in Flint or the pollution in the air and rivers and oceans. Hire 15,000 people because tampering with voting machines is against the law. If we're a nation of laws, if we were a nation of laws, the White House would not have pardoned a racist criminal like Joe Arpaio. Because we're not a nation of laws, we are a nation of privilege. And if we're defending DACA with good intentions, let us not utter platitudes like, well, the kids did nothing wrong, or children should not be punished for the crimes of their parents. Saying things like these are said with good intentions, but they dehumanize. They dehumanize the parents of immigrants. These sorts of sayings function to divide the immigrant community into good and bad immigrants and only serves to divide communities and, yes, divide families. At the Sanctuary Matters Conference, we heard the story of Minerva Cisneros Garcia, who is currently in sanctuary in a church in Greensboro with her 3-year-old and 6-year-old, who are American citizens. Minerva came to the United States 17 years ago with her child who was 5 years old and blind. According to Minerva, in Mexico, the life options for someone who is born blind pretty much consist of living on the street and begging for change with a cup. And when she imagined that as the limited future for her son, she knew that she would do whatever it takes to give him a better life. So she came to the United States because she wanted something better for her son, who is blind. As I look out at the congregation, I know that some of us have special needs children. And every parent that I know in this congregation, every parent I know with a special needs child fights like hell. Fights tooth and nail to get the best services and the best outcomes for their child. Whether that's moving schools, whether that's advocating teachers, whether that's spending what it takes. They advocate nonstop for their child. They get tired doing it. And I can't blame them one bit for fighting for their child as hard as they could. What wouldn't any of us do to give our child a better future? Who among us would not do what Minerva did for her son? So don't give me the, well, those kids did nothing wrong, it's the parents. We might remember that Jesus' own parents took him across borders when he was an infant for the sake of giving him a better life. I don't think you can say you follow Jesus and then in the same breath shame and scold Mary and Joseph. And to stay on the subject, to stay on the subject of changing how we think and how we speak, I would like to advocate for using person-first language always. Always, rather than profit-first language. This is something that I've been guilty of. For example, when I point out that every person from the United States who won a Nobel Prize in science or in math last year, all 6 of those Nobel Prize laureates were immigrants. Dylan won one. He's not an immigrant, but he won it in literature, science and math. All 6 of the winners in science and math. None of them were born in the United States. They were all immigrants. But when I throw out stats like that, I worry that I further a way of thinking that only values people for their productivity, as if capitalism were the highest good. I don't want to ascribe people value because they pick produce or cook meals or clean rooms or build buildings. I don't want to ascribe people value because they will be our future social workers, our pediatric oncology nurses, our translators. I don't want to ascribe people value because they win Nobel Prizes, without first and foremost ascribing people value as mothers and fathers, as children and siblings and grandparents. Without first and foremost describing people value as friends and as neighbors. Without first and foremost describing people value as dreamers, poets, artists, and lovers. without first and foremost ascribing people value as people. As people with worth and with dignity. 2 Sundays ago, 40 people in our church, 10% of our membership, gathered in the sanctuary after the service to learn about a new ministry, the Sanctuary and Refugee Support Ministry, and to learn about what it would mean for us to decide to become a sanctuary congregation. There will be a repeat of this session held this Wednesday at 7 o'clock in the sanctuary, and I really do hope you'll show up for it. I want to end by returning to this idea, of the immigrant in the community. The immigrant doesn't have value because of the work they do. The DACA recipient doesn't have value because of how they might apply their degree in biology or social work or business administration. Any more than I would tell any of you that the extent of your value as a person is what you earn, what you contribute. This is a radical notion. Maybe your value is simply that you are a person and that you are a part of this community. That's universalism. That's the universalist good news. That's the radical example of Jesus, who did not value people by their productivity, but kept company with the sick and the poor and the castaway and the rejected. An economic argument for or against the immigrant is no different than an economic argument against the elderly, or an economic argument against the sick, or an economic argument against children. Why should we have schools? It's not like the children are being productive. It's not like they're producing anything. And it's the same thing as that we should pay for schools only because they are future producers. No. Because they're children. Because they're people. That's person first language, because they're people. And that is why we need people first ways of talking. That is why we need community first ways of talking. That is why we need diversity first ways of thinking. That is why we need to talk and think and most of all love, in terms of our connectedness and in terms of our inherent worth and our inherent dignity. Amen.
Amen.
Our closing hymn this morning is a fun one. I want you to open to number 305, which is the hymn De Colores. And I want to give both some instructions and also some encouragement about this hymn. So the instructions first. You'll notice in hymn 305 that there's, in regular font, there's verse 1, verse 2, and verse 3, and then verse 1 at the bottom in italics and also in Spanish. Well, we're going to be singing three hymns. We're singing three verses. We're going to be singing the one in italics. We'll be singing in Spanish first, and then we're going to sing verse 2, and then we're going to sing verse 3. Does that make sense to everybody? So that's the instructions. Now the encouragement. A lot of people may not know this about me, but that I took Spanish for 7 years. I have 7 years of academic Spanish, and I lived for a time in a Spanish-speaking country. I did my sabbatical living in Ecuador. And I have to tell you that even with 7 years, and even after the experience that I lived in Ecuador, when I have to sing in Spanish, I get a little nervous and a little reticent. But I have to tell you that I want you to sing out, and here's why. Is the De Colores is a song, oh the De Colores, oh the colors. It is a song about diversity. It's a song that says our worth. Our worth is not tied up in being one thing or the other, but that we all have worth. And so I want to tell you that as a singer, your worth as a singer this morning is not tied up in how well you sing and how many notes you hit correctly. This is radical universalism here. that you're encouraged to sing out whether you hit the notes or not, or whether you can pronounce the words or not. You can really sing out. And I have to tell you, a little challenge. The first service, they knocked it out of the park. So I want you, there's more of you here than there were at the first service. So let's close by singing together number 305, De Cloris.